see all your smiling faces out there. I hope you are. Not everybody's smiling. That's better. I've got a few grins over here. Anyway, it's good to see you this morning. And too many people are traveling. But that's what happens in the summer. I hope you brought your umbrellas today, just in case. There's going to be thunderstorms today. Is that news?
Yeah.
No.
It's the same old thing. It's been happening. Do you have any updates on your prayer list or any prayer requests that you want to put on? I have two ladies here. First.
My mother-in-law's PET scan was clear. She is cancer-free. That is our praise. She still has a lot of scar tissue and she's got fluid on the lung. So we'd like to move her from cancer chemotherapy to medical cancer. So she's still got some work to do. She's got some therapy to kind of regain some of that ability that she lost.
Okay.
But it is very good news. Josh's birthday is today.
I told him happy 29th.
Yeah, well, that's just different about
him. You know what he said in the doorway?
He's an old man, an old man's body.
Yeah. No, you know what he said? He says, I can't buy a church.
One update, Rich. Emily's sister Madison is doing much better, so that's a word of praise. But one of my cousins, her name is Rita, she's only about 2 years younger than me. She had a massive heart attack on Friday, and she's been moved to University of Maryland, and they're not sure what is going to happen.
Please put that in on my prayer sheet. Okay. Ms. Sue?
Ken has a friend, and she asked me to put her daughter on the prayer list. Her daughter is 18 years old, and she's a student at the University of Miami. They discovered she had brain cancer. So the parents went and got her, and from there, I guess she'll just do whatever the funds are.
Did you put that on the big sheet? It's in your bulletin.
It's in there already?
No. The pink sheet is in the bulletin.
It is. I thought I lost it.
Christine.
Thank you.
I love it. I love this
thing. I looked for it. I thought I lost it.
Lana's doing better, and she will be leaving Thursday with the 5 kids for around the 50 kids.
Wow.
Yeah. And Christopher did call today, and he has cellulitis.
Tim.
Yes, so Tim was doing good, but yesterday she developed vertigo, and today, like, she has a cold, and trying to keep the cold under control, because her cold can turn into pneumonia. So, and right now, this morning, she's not doing that great. So she was doing good, but that's just way. I mean, I wish we'd get a whole, just a couple weeks in a row, just. You're doing good.
I do. Please continue to pray for my good friend, Mike Turner. He's the one who was, he was on a ladder and the chainsaw came back and hit him in the throat. He fell off. He's been in a coma, an induced coma for three weeks now. I don't know how long it's been now. But they also said he had a massive stroke as well due to the all of that, so they don't know how much damage. I mean, the MRI does say there's been a lot of damage from the stroke, you know, but they haven't been able to take him out of the coma yet because he gets too involved. But he is a man of faith. I know he, I know prayer will help him in this. I mean, at least, if not for him, at least for his family. He was also losing his job that Thursday before the accident, so he don't know about medical and all that. So please pray for him.
Johnny.
I would just like to thank my church family for the beautiful flowers and the cards that I received this week. Thank y'all very much.
One of my mentors, Clarence Byerly, is in there. He has been released. He's at home. Apparently, he
We're grateful for your love and care, your watch care. Where accidents have happened, you've been there. You've helped them not to be worse than they could have been. But you're in control of what happens all around us, and you know this. We just ask your presence to be mighty upon those that have been mentioned this morning, and that you watch over them and provide the healing they need where it's necessary. And that, Father, you give comfort. I think especially the unspoken request that's on the bulletin right now, and ask that you will be with that family, Father, in a very special way as they walk through some difficulties. We just ask your blessing to be upon each one of us as we hear your word today, that you would hear it and be obedient to what we hear. And we give praise and honor and glory to Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Hey everyone, it's me, Doug, from the Baptist Convention Disaster Relief. I'm here with Juan Willoughby from the Broken Wall Project and Dave McMillan from Emergency Management, and we're here in Catonsville. And just real quick, guys, Juan, some things you've heard, some things that happened personally. Tell me something, what you've seen over from the floor.
Yeah, I know that there's been a lot of attention over in Ellicott City, but here in West Baltimore, we just had a river. We had a river down Frederick Road. I had a river behind my house. And unfortunately, once again, my whole basement has been flooded. But thankfully for us, it was only 3 or 4 inches. Because if I go half a block down on Frederick from where I live, there were folks who had 3 or 4 feet. And if I go another block down, there's a fellow said when he walked into his front door, there was water on the first floor. So that means at least 8 feet of water. Now, one of the things you can do is you can pray for us. If you got some time and you want to, you don't mind getting dirty, then come help us get some people's homes to the place where we can start to restore it. That would be awesome. We got the brilliant disaster relief guys here. Please pray for us. And if you can't do any of that, just send us your money.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. So, Dave, some things that you've seen over here since you've been walking around. That's early.
Yeah.
And so, nice Memorial Day weekend. What's the things that you've seen so far?
So, starting with Sunday, we had 21 rescues from this disaster on the west side of the city. No injuries and no deaths, so thank God for that. And continue to pray for those people that they find peace. And there's a lot of people who are dealing with effects in their basement. We had feet as deep during that rescue, 7 feet. So, you know, first responders were having to swim to go get people who were trapped in buses and onto cars. So we're very blessed that no one got hurt there. Thank you for the work of first responders and God for blessing them. On top of that, we obviously have impacted a lot of debris strewn down the street, heavy road damage, damage to some homes, some people displaced. So pray for them. And if you can donate or donate time or money, that's always welcome, and prayer is welcome too. But we're very happy that this wasn't worse, and we continue to hope for full recovery.
So there you go, guys. There's a lot of work down here in West Baltimore, in Ellicott City, and Howard County, so keep praying for us. If you want to volunteer, you can go through Disaster Relief on our website, bcv.org, and we'll tell you that. There's also a spot there if you're interested in donations. All the donations that will come in will be going right here to help those that were affected by the flood. So we appreciate your prayers, appreciate your help. Hopefully look forward to seeing you down here help out. Thanks a lot. Hey, everyone.
Oh.
Some of you know the praise team. We go over to down to Colonial Landing about once a month now, and we're limited the songs we can sing because we have to bring our own music. And I suggested to the praise team the other night that if they wanted to work up this song, we could sing it sometime. And I see that Bobby and Brian are not here, so I'm about to scare them off. No, actually, Brian's down home with his folks, and Bob is out in Oregon. And so the name of the song is Gone.
Is defeated and gone.
shirts. Got a few fill-ins for you. Got a couple of just housekeeping items. The clip we saw from Mission Moments, I just wanted to let you know that if you want to donate to that, just grab one of the envelopes out of the back of the pew and put Axon A, or Catonsville, or Ellicott City, or the Flood, or what have you. 100% of those funds will go to BCMD to help the folks that are out there. I know they're providing meals. They have, I don't know if they brought up the shower facilities, and the washing. They have semi-trailers with full washing machines, and they do people laundry. And they have full of showers, and they let people get a shower. And, Judy and I, in the classes, trained with one of the meal trailers that they can provide 5,000 meals a day. And so BCMD is on the ground operating in the community, and you can be a part of that. If you can't physically go there, you can pray, you can send the dollars. This week we hear of some celebrities, in some circles well-known people, who decided to end their lives. And then we hear, some of you are familiar with Charles Krauthammer. Charles Krauthammer, a medical doctor, psychologist, featured a lot on Fox News and other programs, analysis. I've been a fan of his for many, many years. I'm an amateur student of psychology, and he was a psychiatrist. And Charles had an operation in the fall, in August, and for those that don't know, due to a diving accident, he's paralyzed from the chest down from the age of 22, and I believe he's 68. And so he struggled for many, many years, but he had a zest for life unequaled in a lot of people. He had the surgery, thought they'd gotten everything, and went back in for a follow-up. And they said the cancer had returned very aggressively, and he only had weeks to live. You know, we discussed in Deacon's meeting yesterday, it's bad when the doctor says, you need an operation. We need to cut you open and fix you and do something. You know what's even worse? When the doctor said, there's nothing we can do. Absolutely. So for anyone, you know, Brother Wayne, I know you're not looking forward to the surgery, but thank God they can do something, and hopefully it comes out well, and our prayers are with you.
Amen.
The couple of things going on, if you read the Washington Post, I don't know why you would do that, but if you do, one of their reporters has a wild hair about the Southern Baptist Convention. Now, Judy and I are going to be in the, Judy's going to be working remotely, but I will be at the convention, and it's going to be noisy, and there's a lot of things going on from a lot of different directions. So ask you to pray for unity for the Southern Baptist Convention. There's going to be a lot of news media there. Need to pray that Pastor Ken keeps his mouth shut when someone sticks a microphone. When and if someone sticks a microphone under my nose, that I keep my big mouth shut, because it's a no-win situation. But for those that have heard some of the things that are going on, I direct you to, and they're back on the table, we passed them out before, the Baptist Faith and Message. This is the official document what the Southern Baptist Convention believes and what our stand is. And so right in the middle, pages 12 and 13, God's purpose of grace and the church. I can tell you this, I don't have more information or I would share it, but there are several groups of people, Calvinists and Arminians, they're on opposite sides of the spectrum. If I can go aside for a second, in the political arena, you've got the wild-eyed lunatics on each side of the spectrum, about 15 to 20%. then most of us fall in the middle where, okay, that makes a little bit of sense, that makes a little bit of sense, and we can talk reasonably among ourselves. Then you have the wild-eyed lunatics on either side that just want to scream. And we've seen it on TV, and we've read about it, and all of that type of thing. So you have the Calvinists over on one side, the Arminians on the other side, and they're trying to change things around. I would address that in God's purpose of grace, and we'll address it further down the road. And then you have a number of groups that believe the church needs to be more socially active. And I believe the church should be socially active. There are many things we can do as citizens and members of our community. We do have responsibilities. But we have to remember what the purpose of the church is. Now, I'm familiar with pastors and churches that feed the hungry. They have a soup kitchen. That's a wonderful thing. But that's not the total purpose of the church. It's a good thing, but it's not the purpose of the church as ordained in Scripture. And so I invite you, if you don't have a copy, you should have a copy in your Bible. So when you read and you have a question, you can go and see what the official Southern Baptist idea is on it. But they're right on the table back there. I invite you to take one. Take it with you and catch up on it. Okay. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verses 7 through 8. Cracked pot or crackpot? Now, I read a book, God Uses Cracked Pots. God uses crackpots too, but in the opposite direction. But there's a fine line between a crackpot and a cracked pot. See about that in a minute. Following, continuing in our series, It's Not Too Late for You. God uses less than perfect people. We all fall into that category. 2 Corinthians, read with me. But we have this treasure in clay pots so that the awesome power belongs to God and doesn't come from us. We are experiencing all kinds of trouble, but we aren't crushed. We are confused, but we aren't depressed. Let's pray. Now, Lord, we pray that you take these words today as we open your word and we look at the truths, that we can establish in our hearts the things that we need to do, we need to pray for, we need to strive for. In your name we ask. Amen. Stories told of two paddle boats at the turn of the century heading down the Mississippi River to New Orleans. And as they traveled side by side, the sailors were kind of yelling back and forth, as sailors do and as guys do, and challenging each other. And so one kicked it up a little bit, went a little faster, and the other one kicked it up a little bit, went a little faster, and pretty soon it was a full-scale race. One boat began falling behind because they didn't have enough fuel. See, they had enough fuel to take the leisurely travel down the Mississippi, but to race, that used a lot more fuel, a lot more energy. And they were out, and they weren't going to lose. So what they started doing was looking at the cargo they were carrying. And they found that if they threw the cargo into that blast furnace, it burned just as good as coal did. And so each of them started taking their cargo, throwing it in, so they could race down. Well, obviously one team won the race, but both teams lost their cargo. God has entrusted to you and I precious cargo. Might be our children, might be our spouse, might be our friends, might be some of our relatives, might be our neighbors. And our job is to do our part in making sure this precious cargo that God has entrusted to us reaches its proper destination. Lots of churches have lots of programs, but when the program takes priority over people, people often suffer. When the cares of this temporary life take priority over the eternal commands of Jesus, things and people get thrown overboard. Have you allowed the distraction of the race of life to destroy your only reason for being on earth? I read of the celebrity chef. Seemed like he had everything going for him. Money, fame, traveling all over the world. The lady who designed handbags and fashion in New York City. You would think that they were on top of the world, but they didn't know why they were on earth. How much cargo will you sacrifice in order to achieve the number one slot in your mind? How many people never reach the destination because of the aggressiveness of a competitive captain or coach or boss or mom or dad or the Joneses? They throw it all away. Before Jesus returned to heaven, he gave his disciples simple instructions. Matthew 28. God authorized and commanded me, this is out of the message. God authorized and commanded me to commission you. Go out and train everyone you meet, far and near, in this way of life, marking them by baptism in the threefold name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Then instruct them in the practice of all I have commanded you. I'll be with you as long as you do this day after day, right up until the end of the age. See, there is a day that this earth will cease. Now, if you're listening to the environmentalists, that they don't have it totally right. This world will be destroyed. But first, God is going to set up his thousand-year kingdom on this earth. So when one of the environmental, and believe me, I like to drink clean water. I like to breathe clean air. Some of these folks have taken Mother Earth and exalted her to a deity. God will set up his kingdom on this earth. Man could not destroy this earth if he wanted to. God would not allow it. So keep that in mind when you hear a lot of this crazy stuff going on out there. Quite simply, when Jesus talked to his disciples before he left, he said, teach people to love God and love others. Wow, what a concept. If you love God and you love others, Phil from Duck Dynasty said, bring the commandments down to two. Love God and don't steal anybody's stuff. Wow, what a difference would that make in our world, huh? Can't keep the Ten Commandments? Can you keep those two? Love God, worship him, learn more about him. Love others, serve others, disciple others. That is, train others. I'm going to ask, and certainly no raise of hands here. May get a little uncomfortable, but I'll blame that on the Holy Spirit. We need to take inventory in our lives and our effectiveness. How many people have accepted Jesus as their Savior? Because of you. How many people have been baptized and joined the church because of you and your influence? How many people are now active making other disciples because of you? I know, it's not an amen, it's an oh me. Preacher, quit meddling and get back to preaching. Okay, I will. Because it's a difficult question. But it's a question. It's a question, if you're uncomfortable when I'm asking it, how about when you stand before Jesus in heaven and he asks you the very same question? If none, why? Well, one of them, the biggest one probably, is the distractions of life. All of us, from the youngest to the oldest, we have distractions. Matthew 13, the one on whom seed was sown in the rocky places, this is the man who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy.
Yet he has no firm root in himself, but it's only temporary. And when affliction or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he falls away. And the one whom seed was sown among the thorns, this is the man who hears the word, and the worry of the world and the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, and it becomes unfruitful. There are people that once called Elkridge Baptist Church their home, but they're not here anymore. Why? This could be part of it. The cares of the world have choked out the spiritual things of God. See, everyday life distracts us from the eternal. You ever take a dog for a walk? If the object of the endeavor is to help the dog answer nature's call outside and not on the carpet, you're walking down the street and then all of a sudden a squirrel runs by. And the dog forgets why we're out there in the first place. A bird used to have a notification on his email. And whenever he'd get an email, he'd say, "Squirrel!" I thought that was hilarious. He changed it to something else now. But how many times have you and I been doing something and all of a sudden an email pops or a Facebook pops or something pops that we see and all of a sudden we're distracted and going off in a different direction? Your squirrel might be email or Facebook or TV or a phone call. Personally, I'm in love with Home Depot. I go there several times a day during the week because we have properties and they have stuff I need. Now, you know, Bob Horsey and I, we need to do a song about Home Depot like we did one about Chick-fil-A. In fact, we sang, for those that don't know, Tim Hawkins, look it up if you haven't heard it, sings a song to the tune of Paul McCartney's Yesterday. His words are Chick-fil-A. I could eat there 7 times a day. I'm in love with Chick-fil-A. It's hilarious. That was the number one song. Last time when we were at Colonial Landing. That's the one I think they want us to sing again. But anyways, when I go to Home Depot, I better have a list. Because they have 40,000 items on the shelf. And if I don't have my list that I know what I'm going to go get, I'll probably look at 35,000 of those items. And then walk out of the store with a cart full of stuff and not get what I went in there after initially. You might go to other stores and do that. But that's me. I get distracted in Home Depot. It's hard to keep focused. You've got these display dumps all over the place luring me. Everyday life can distract us from the eternal. Satan will throw things deliberately at us to keep us from focusing on the eternal. So I don't have a dog, but 2 things I know about dogs, they're easily distracted, and you never trust a dog to guard your lunch. Those are things that I don't have a dog, and I know those are true. Life has distractions. All right, 2nd thing, tyranny of the urgent. The biggest problem in America today is we're going in so many directions. Luke chapter 10, but the Lord answered and said, "Martha, Martha, you're worried and bothered about so many things, but only one thing is necessary, for Mary has chosen the good part, which shall not be taken away from her." You all know the story. I don't need to get into it at this time. But the urgent, the tyranny of the urgent. There are so many things that are urgent. And I had to learn a long time ago when I was a commissioned salesman. And what a commissioned salesman means, you don't sell something you don't eat. Your paycheck is based on what you sell. And you can get distracted. And activity does not always equal productivity. Now, I was a shade tree mechanic. I was never good enough at it to make money at it. But what I have found is that a 20-minute job, if you turn off a bolt, break it off, can turn into a two-day job. And that's if you've got the right tool by the time you drill it out and back it out and do it all over again. It can just be horrible. The tyranny of the urgent. But you've got it all torn down. You've got to put it back together again. You can't get paid until it's working again. Have you ever wished for a 30-hour day? I mean, surely this extra time would help relieve the tremendous pressure that we have to get things done. I mean, our lives are a trail of unfinished tasks. I was looking this morning. I've got a pile of books about this big from last year's Southern Baptist Convention that I haven't read yet. I mean, I've glanced through them, but I haven't read them totally. And I'm taking another suitcase because I know I'm going to bring home a bunch again. Our lives are full of unfinished tasks. Unanswered letters, unvisited friends, unwritten articles, unread books, they haunt the quiet moments where you sit down and you have a minute and then you think, where do I start? Because I've got so much to do. We desperately need relief. But would a 30-hour day really relieve the problem? Because I submit to you that we would stuff more into it and then we'd be just as frustrated. A mother's work is never finished. Neither is that of any student, teacher, minister, or anyone else we know. Nor will the passage of time help us catch up. There's just more. Children grow in number and age to require more of our time. Greater experience and profession and church brings more exacting assignments. So we find ourselves working more and more and enjoying it less. And then sometimes, and I've been there, where you are so much caught up in the cycle, you can't afford to quit. You can't afford not to work. And some of that we bring on ourselves. There are those, you know, the doctors tell us that we should sleep 7-8 hours a night. I know some moms would be just on top of the world. That my daughter-in-law with Duke, she's learning that right now. That you can have one, and you have the second one, and it's not twice as much work. It's maybe 3 or 4 times as much work. But we just heard about a couple who had a child at home and then had triplets come home. Oh, my aching back hurts me just to think about it. But there are those, there are about 1-3% of the population that can get by on less than 7-8 hours sleep. Throw a few names out there. Kelly Ripa, host of Live with Kelly and Michael, 4 or 5 hours a night. Jay Leno, 5 hours. Herb Kelleher, founder of Southwest Airlines, 4 hours. Condi Rice, former U.S. Secretary of State, 4 hours. Barack Obama, 4 or 5 hours. Bill Clinton, 5 hours. Thomas Edison, 4. Benjamin Franklin, about that number. Margaret Thatcher, President Trump. Trump said something on the campaign trail. He said, you know, I'm not a big sleeper. I like 3 hours, 4 hours. I toss, I turn. I want to get up and find out what's going on. So there are those that have extended their day by sleeping less. No thank you. Not going to be involved. Bottom line is we all have the same exact amount of time. It's how we use it. Never enough time. Never enough money. Got some acquaintances from upstate New York. Wife just took a job in D.C., moving down to Virginia, selling their nice house up north. I said, wow, wait till that sticker shock hits you. Do you know that in Maryland, the average cost of a house is 68% more than the rest of the United States? The average house in the median, this is the middle, in Maryland, $288,000. Now think about that for a second. You get a 30-year mortgage with even with 20% down, you're talking $1,500 a month. And then the average car payment now is $500, a couple of car payments. You're spending $30,000 a year just for cars, just for transportation and housing. How does anyone make a budget meet? Here's the thing. If you have never looked at an amortization schedule on your new house, you'll see that the majority the majority of those payments for the first 15 years are interest going to the bank. LA to Dallas, Boston to New York City, the largest buildings in the biggest cities are banks because they charge the interest that you and I willingly pay. Now, to be fair, the banks do give us a piece of candy when we go in. If they don't give you one, you can ask for it. Isn't it ironic? Who can tell me what the piece of candy is they'll give you at a bank? A sucker! Is that on purpose? Are they really playing games with us? A sucker is what they give you. Here's the thing. When your outgo exceeds your income, then your upkeep becomes your downfall. And all across the country, people are up to here in debt. And I hear Dave Ramsey talking about two doctors and a lawyer, two doctors in the family, two lawyers in the family, a lawyer and a doctor, big incomes. And they're still right to here. They're living paycheck to paycheck. Tyranny of the urge, distractions of life. There is a way to get a handle on this stuff. It's not easy, but it's doable. Jesus points us in a different direction than the tyranny of the urge or the distractions of life. The priority of the eternal. Jesus said, "Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves break in and steal, but store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also." We must focus on the things that last, not on temporary things. Dr. Bob Jones used to say, "Don't sacrifice the permanent on the altar of the temporary." It's been reported that over a doorway of a great European cathedral, there are three inscriptions spanning the arches. Over one is carved a beautiful wreath of roses, and underneath it says, "All which pleases is but for a moment." Over the other is sculptured a cross, and there are the words, "All that which troubles us is but for a moment." Then on the third is the inscription, "That only is important which is eternal." One of the things we can start cutting out in the tyranny of the urgent and we're too busy, use the Ben Franklin balance sheet. For those of you who don't know what it is, you put a cross on a piece of paper and a yes and a no. Well, do it a little bit different. Put eternal and temporary. You know, that new car that you worked so hard for in 5 years is going to be a piece of rust. Going to be ready for the scrapyard. What's eternal? Are you spending your time doing eternal things? Are you spending your money doing eternal things? Are you spending your talent doing eternal things? But we have this treasure in clay pots so that the awesome power belongs to God and doesn't come from us. Three things quickly, and with this I'll close. How do we get around it? Set your mind. Scripture, Colossians, set your hearts on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. Two, seek godly counsel. If in doubt, check it out. Talk to someone. Find a mentor. Plans fail for lack of counsel, but with many advisors they succeed. Proverbs 15:22, and then on the screen, Proverbs 19, listen to advice and accept discipline. At the end, you will be counted among the wise. And then finally, settle your past. I talk to people every day that are so caught up in the past mistakes they've made, they cannot operate in the present and look to the future. Settle your past.
is behind, straining toward what is ahead. I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. In your car, the seat behind you, there's a mirror about that big and a little one on each side. And on the one over here, it usually says objects appear closer than they really are. But you have a large windshield. You should spend most of your time looking forward. Be aware of what's coming up or what has happened in the past. But your focus ought to be on where you're going. Cracked pot or cracked pot? We should all be cracked pots for the Lord. That is, people can see that it's not us, but it's the Lord Jesus Christ in us that is a blessing to them and to society. And we also need to keep our focus on things that are eternal. Let's all stand together. We're going to work. Now, Lord, we're thankful for your words. We're thankful for the knowledge that we can get out of Scripture. We're thankful for church friends that can pray for us when we're having problems and counsel us when we're feeling down. And Lord, we appreciate this church family. We just pray that you would guide now and direct if there's one here today that's just going through a real troublesome time. Lord, that you'd put your hand on their heart and you would comfort them. We pray that they would look for a mentor, someone to help guide them through, talk these things through. We pray that you guide now and direct in the remainder of the service. In your name we ask. Amen. We're going to remain standing for a word of prayer. If you have a need in your heart, be yours.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
guide us now and direct us. We pray that you be with the meeting down in Dallas, that the Southern Baptists will keep their eyes focused on you and why we're here on this earth. Take us now to our home, bring us back together at the next appointed time. In your name we ask. Amen.